President Trump today heads south. He is in Nashville talking farming and then to Atlanta to watch football. The president is promoting his tax overhaul to farmers. He plans to speed up federal permits to allow broadband expansion in rural areas. And he has a seat at the college football's national championship game between Bama and Georgia. Joining me now to talk about the administration and the president's possible 2020 competitor is Vince Colonnaise, editorial director at The Daily Caller. Welcome back.
Thank you.
This weekend, the president convened Republicans at Camp David, and the goal was to talk about 2018, and I'm sure they were doing a lot of high fives over tax reform. But looking forward, they have a couple of different options. First, they have to keep the government going by January 19th, but then they're talking welfare, they're talking immigration, they're talking infrastructure. Which of these is the most politically expedient going into this election
year? Well, clearly getting the budget done, January 19th is the deadline for them to keep the government open. So they've got to do something there whether they like it or not. The things that are not expedient right now, it seems like welfare reform. The president's sending a clear signal from Camp David this weekend that welfare reform might stay on the back burner until next year at least. Because they need to find some bipartisan consensus. Where they're getting consensus appears to be on immigration, meaning they're at the table at least and having conversations with Democrats. At this point, not clear whether Democrats are willing to shut the government down over an immigration fight, but immigration definitely playing a huge role.
This weekend, let's move on to Steve Bannon and the book written about the Trump administration, Fire and Fury. It came out last week. In the book, his former chief strategist described a meeting between Donald Trump Jr., senior campaign aides, and a Russian lawyer as treasonous and unpatriotic. Let's take a look at this apology that Steve Bannon wrote. It says in part, Donald Trump Jr. is both a patriot and a good man. My support is also unwavering for the president and his agenda. President Trump was the only candidate who could have taken on and defeated the Clinton apparatus. I mean, that's as big of a backpedaling as I've seen in a long time in Washington.
Right. And he said that the men who were in the room, Paul Manafort, Jared Kushner, and Don Jr. in the prior statement, were the ones who were guilty of this treasonous behavior. Now he's saying it was just Paul Manafort I was talking about, but the implication there is that he thinks that Don Jr. was too naive to have realized it was treasonous. I don't think his backpedal or this so-called apology is going to accomplish what he hopes to accomplish, which is to get back in the good graces of the Trump White House.
I don't think it's ever going to happen. And according today to a press briefing on, I think it was in on the airplane on Air Force One, they said, you know, they were making it pretty clear, you know, you attack the kids, I'm sorry, I think you're gone. All right, let's go on to the last night, the Golden Globes.
Yes.
We saw Oprah Winfrey giving a pretty incredible speech. She was accepting the Cecil B. DeMille Award, passionate speech about race and the Me Too movements. And now celebrities are dubbing Oprah as our future president?
Of course,
Does this story have legs?
Yeah, it does, because it's Oprah, and anything Oprah touches or is involved with has legs. But I think here is kind of funny the hypocrisy of Hollywood, which is to say they spend so much time on that stage saying that Donald Trump is uniquely unqualified to be president because he lacks political experience and he was merely a star in entertainment. And a billionaire. That's Oprah's life story. So we'll see. We'll see if they stand behind, keep pushing her for president for 2020. Starting to see some reporting already that she's even open to the idea.
I've heard that, and it's trending on Twitter. And
it
must mean it's something's happening. All right. Vince Colonnaise, editorial director at The Daily Caller. Thanks for joining
us. Thanks, Lauren.